Let's Talk podcast guests are invited to share their unique perspectives regarding diversity, equity, and inclusion. The ideas expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the practices of Mesquite ISD and are not an endorsement of any particular agenda or viewpoint.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD's Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So let's have a real conversation about embracing our differences and finding common ground with your hosts, Dr. LaDonna Gully and Ted Maddox.
Welcome to episode 43 of the Let's Talk podcast. Today we are framing our conversation around the really young kids, the pre-K boys and girls from Mesquite ISD, and we're excited to talk to our guest about that. But we'll start with the introductions. We do this every week in case you don't listen, so pay attention. My name is Ted Madden. I work for the communications department for Mesquite ISD, and I'm a 48-year-old white man.
My name is Dr. LaDonna Gully. I am the Director over Leadership and Empowerment for our district, and I am a 51-year-old African-American woman.
My name is Jean Pricer. I am the pre-K facilitator for the district, and I am a 40-year-old Filipino-American.
So tell us about yourself. How did you get into education, and how have you gone from where you started to where you are now?
Well, I've always known that I wanted to work with children. When I first went to college, I did start as a pre-dental major, but I knew that I wanted to be a pediatric dentist. After a few of those tough classes, I realized that I might not have been cut out for that. So I went the child development route and then ended up in education. So that was at the great school of the University of Texas at Austin, Hook'em Horns. Sorry, I had to get that plug in there.
Absolutely.
After studying at UT, I also did a summer abroad in Spain. So I have a minor in Spanish as well. I got my bilingual teaching certification from early childhood to fourth grade and started right here in Mesquite 18 years ago.
That is amazing.
Yes. Time really does fly, and mm-hmm. It's been a journey. So I started at J.H. Florence Elementary School back when it was in the old building. I'm so sad that I didn't get the opportunity to teach in the beautiful new building that they have now. But I was, kindergarten, first grade, second grade, fourth grade, and, of course, pre-K teacher. At Florence for 12 years. And then for 3 years, I was the instructional specialist at Augsburg Elementary. And this is my third year in this role as pre-K facilitator for the district.
You taught basically pre-K through fifth grade. Mm-hmm. I've got a fourth grader, a second grader, and a pre-K-er.
Yeah.
And I can tell you exactly which one is my favorite, but I think it's more personality-based than... grade-based. Did you have a favorite grade is the question.
Well, obviously, I my passion lies in early childhood. I just love seeing those kids come to you just ready to learn, blank slates almost. And then when they leave you, it is just so amazing to see everything that they've learned in a year. The pre-K year, I would go home so exhausted, but, those were my favorite times.
Mm-hmm. And don't they say the darndest things?
Oh my goodness. Yes. Like I probably have lots of stories. That's for another day. You invite me back and maybe I'll have some more stories of all the things that, I've heard in coming out of the mouths of four-year-olds.
Yeah. They are very, very funny. And so you taught a little bit about bilingual because you taught bilingual education. And, of course, You are Filipino-American. So talk to us about that journey.
Yes, it's a very interesting one. I started learning Spanish in seventh grade. So where I grew up here in Garland. They started offering Spanish classes in seventh grade. And from then on, I went all the way through high school. I took some in college as well. And that prepared me to, take that oral language proficiency test that you have to pass to become a bilingual teacher. And so it took a lot of hard work and just, immersing yourself into that culture and then, forcing yourself to speak Spanish. Or because I go home in the summer, I would always say, I would go home in the summers and I didn't have anybody to speak Spanish to because my kids don't speak Spanish. My family doesn't speak Spanish. But I know that first day of school, the following school year, I'd be real rusty. But, the kids and the parents would, they would clean that rust off real fast. So, no, but yeah, the language that my parents speak at home, it's called Tagalog. And it has a lot of Spanish words in it because the Spaniards colonized the Philippines. I'm not one to give you a history lesson, but it happened a long time ago. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of, Spanish influences in the Filipino language. So actually, when I studied abroad in Spain, I did do one of my research papers was on that similarity. And so I'll give you an example. In Spanish, to say, how are you? You say, ¿cómo está? Mm-hmm. In Tagalog, it's ¿kumusta ka? So it's a little bit.
Oh wow!
It's very similar, but it's just a little bit different.
Is it a little bit like the similarities between Latin and Spanish, or is it not as close or not as similar?
There are some. It can overlap like that. But then there's other indigenous languages that have found its way into the Tagalog as well. So mm-hmm. It's just a blend, just like any other language. It's a blend mm-hmm. of the people that live there or that use it.
Is it Tagalog?
Tagalog, yes.
Tagalog. Do you speak it?
I wish I did.
Okay.
I try to communicate with my parents, and it always comes out in Spanish, and they're like, I don't know what you just said. But no, when we were little, our parents spoke to us in Tagalog, so I understand it. I'm a receptive language in Tagalog. Very good. Mm-hmm. But... yes. I can read it. It takes a little bit, but to speak it just doesn't come to me as naturally as Spanish does.
Do your parents ever talk to you about, man, we wish we had done a better job with making sure that you were very fluent with?
They've mentioned it a few times, but the fact that we still, we still understand our culture. Like, I grew up dancing Filipino folk dances, and we would travel to different parts of the state doing things like that. And, just sharing Great. Our culture. I think nowadays, here in over there by Price, there's a new Filipino restaurant. Like, I just feel like the Filipino culture is, it's getting a little recognition mm-hmm. More recently. So, yeah. So
I'm curious just what your life perspective is as someone who is essentially tricultural. I don't know if that's given you too big of a title, but you've been immersed to some degree in three different cultures. I am as mm-hmm. a white American mutt as you can be. I'm from the United States. And I don't know. So I just kind of wonder, as you kind of make your way through Mesquite, Texas, and this part of the world, how you observe things from those kind of having those three different perspectives.
Yeah, it's interesting because, like you said, I mean, I was born here. I was born and raised right here down the street, Garland, Texas. But I don't look like, a lot of the people that I grew up with. I remember at one time, in health class in elementary school, people would, have to bring in a log of everything you ate that that week or whatever, I would turn my log in and be like, I ate a hamburger one night. We had pizza one night. We had hot dogs. Like, we didn't eat that. My parents didn't feed us that. Like,
but you just wanted to fit
but in? But it was maybe a feeling of wanting to fit in, but also maybe like, I don't want to say embarrassed, but I didn't want to have to explain, like, sinigang. What's sinigang? Oh, that's a soup with lots of vegetables in it. It's tamarind, but, you know.
Yeah, right.
Like, people aren't going to know, like, the real foods that we eat at home. Like, mm-hmm. I could write rice on there, you know. You eat rice every day?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, we do.
That's interesting that you talk about just not want, right, having to kind of feel like you needed to put more American traditional dishes as opposed to your own dishes. Was it because you probably thought people wouldn't understand?
I think a little bit of that. Maybe wanting to be like everybody else. I don't, like, nowadays, like, I'm proud Filipino, you know, like, go Manny Pacquiao. I just read, I'm on Instagram, and, you know, there's a Filipino group that I follow, and they highlight Filipino-Americans.
Yes.
I did not know that Olivia Rodrigo is Filipino, a Filipino-American. Like, her grandparents were from the Philippines, or great-grandparents, I can't remember. But, like, it's just like, oh, look, they're just like me. Like, yeah. I feel like it's more accepted these days to, mm-hmm. to not be like everybody else.
I think when you're growing up, too, you know, I mean, a lot of people just, you just want to get along. You just want to kind of be included. And even if the attention you got with a teacher asking you about that soup in health class, it wouldn't be bad attention. It wouldn't be embarrassing necessarily, but you probably just didn't want any more attention than any of the other kids. Because you get singled out that way, even if it's not for a bad reason.
And I remember, I don't know why all of my examples go around food. I mean, it's because I like food so much.
One of our last guests, everything was about a party.
Yeah.
Carolina.
Well, I remember at one time, it was in elementary school, we were having some kind of multicultural fair, and everybody was supposed to bring some kind of a dish. Well, mm-hmm. I had my dad, like, make some fried rice or something very basic, mm-hmm. and they were like, ooh, you get to eat this all the time, and, you know, so maybe it wasn't a bad thing to be mm-hmm. different, or, you know, not eat hamburgers and hot dogs every night, or your typical, I don't even know if there's a typical American food.
It's chicken nuggets now.
Oh my gosh.
Right?
That's all my daughter eats is chicken nuggets, French fries, and ketchup. She's 8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And very healthy, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Chicken nuggets are a big hit in the Madden household, too.
Oh, we keep Tyson in business.
Well, so culture is important.
Yes.
And why is that?
Well, I mean, it's who you are. It makes up who you are. And I think wherever you come from, whatever, you know, however you grew up, you should value it. And, you know, it's part of you. And, you know, share it. Share mm-hmm. about it. I love, love, love the fact that there are so many children's books these days based on, and it's not just race, culture, kids with glasses,
yes.
Kids with two moms, two dads, mm-hmm. you know, kids in wheelchairs.
Yes.
There's a book out there to explain or to, you know, to connect to any kind of situation.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I'm a book nerd, and I just love all the books that are coming out, just, you know, that are about diversity, ways that people are different. And, you know, we just accept it all and, you know, value and celebrate it. Celebrate everybody's differences. That's what makes us us.
Absolutely. It is what makes us us. And when we talk about inclusivity, I think that our intention of being very inclusive and making sure that, you know, we are making sure that everybody counts, that everyone matters. And when we have discussions about things like policy and about procedures and about practices within our own district, that we are making sure that we're going to bring everybody to the table and that we're going to consider everyone. That's where the acceptance factor really comes in. And so it's really nice to hear, because I think that oftentimes we can, if we're not careful, you know, we can really easily retreat to our own way of thinking, right? And so that's why it's really important that we're making sure that we're bringing these wonderful voices to the table to be heard, and those experiences, so that people can be like, hey, I hadn't thought about it that way, or I hadn't considered it that way. And so, yeah, when you talked about why culture is important, it is. It's so important. It's really important that we're bringing all of us, all of our experiences to the table each and every day. And so when we talk about pre-K, what's special about it?
Well, like I said, pre-K has a very special place in my heart. We're teaching our youngest learners here in the district, and it's just a great place to, you know, like we were talking about earlier, level the playing ground, because not everybody has the same opportunities at home, let's say, because from birth to we have pre-K programs for bilingual 3-year-olds. Yes. So from birth to three, it's very important. Our babies' brains are developing. It's a very crucial time in brain development times. So a big thing that we need to do, parents should do at home, is just start with conversations. Like, you know, oral language is a big thing that we focus on here in our pre-K program. Because, I mean, that's how we communicate, you know, oral language, communicating your needs, things that you want, or, you know, just how are you feeling? And if they're coming to us without that background of communication, oral language, they're already starting way behind. So, you know, just that oral language and communication and conversations at home, like that, that's a big thing that we can, that, you know, parents can help us, you know, promote. And then once they get to us, we can teach them how to be in school. Like, I know right now in classrooms that I've been in visiting, there's been a challenge of, you know, certain behaviors that we're seeing. And it's partly because of not being able to be social like we used to be pre-COVID. Mm-hmm. You don't realize how important it is to be exposed, or to, you know, the being with other people. You learn a lot just walking through the store, or, you know, going to the park and playing with other kids. Our babies that are coming to us right now, they are very limited in those experiences. So, you know, our pre-K program, once they get to us, we help catch them up to where they should be, so that when they get to kindergarten and move up to the other grades, you know, they do have, you know, they do have the ability to communicate, to know how to be in school, to, you know, just have those routines and procedures down. Because a lot of pre-K, a lot of people think that in pre-K we just play. Well, you know what? Pre-K is fun, but it's purposeful play. We're playing, but there's a reason why we do certain things. Like, you might walk into a pre-K class and all they're doing is playing with Play-Doh. But you know what? You know what? Play-Doh is a really good thing.
Great tool.
It builds, like, the fine muscles in your hands that eventually help you to write, to just do those actions that you have to use your hands. I mean, mm-hmm. How often do we use our hands? Like, all the time, all day. So, I mean, Play-Doh is, like, a great tool to use to build those muscles. So, I mean, yes, it might look like, to an outsider, all we do is play, but there's always something. There's a purpose to it.
Mm-hmm. You know, as we as people get older, I feel like, you know, we become a little bit more polluted, right? We get influenced by cultural biases, and we have implicit bias because of that. And so I want you to talk about what these kids are like really early on. And just, you know, we talk about how kids don't really see race or understand race or when they're really young. And it's kind of the idea that we'd love to be back in that utopian society where none of us saw color or saw the differences between the colors we see and saw one is better or one is worse. So what do you see from these kids when it comes to that?
So in classrooms or when working with, you know, these little kids, you see a lot. a lot of the things that you that we run into, it's almost learned, like a learned behavior or a learned something that they've seen previously. But you know, for the most part, kids are kids, and they just like the interaction with others. Mm-hmm. So when they're coming to the classrooms, like you were saying, they don't see color. Oh, he likes to play with Legos just like I do.
Yes.
They see big picture. Like they don't zoom in on those into those differences unless those differences are really pointed out.
I definitely would agree with that. I just from my experiences teaching elementary as well as being an administrator, very little interaction or discussion with students, very young students, any about race or about understanding even gender or anything. I mean, our kids are just kids, and they're just figuring it out. And they don't see any differences truly until someone else kind of points it out to them that is an actual difference. And I think it's always sad because it's taken away the innocence.
Yeah, there's a purity that gets lost.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
It happened to all of us.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Even if at our age and in our position, especially with this podcast, we are doing our best to fight against it.
Yeah.
We're having to consciously fight against it.
Kids, yes.
Kids, when they're born and just thrown in together, they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just what's sad about it, is just that purity is taken from them.
Mm-hmm. It is. And I think that this is also why it's so important that educators in particular really help students begin to see themselves in books, mm-hmm. in stories, in math, in science, in social studies. That students begin to see themselves so that they realize that we're all here really trying to do a really good job working hard to be great human beings. And because that's really what it's about. It's about how do I really help students become great human beings, mm-hmm. and acknowledge. Here's the thing. There's nothing wrong with who we are or what we look like. There's nothing wrong with that until we make it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know as just as an educator myself, I always really strive to help my students understand that you are great and we need to honor each other. You know, this is an asset. Having all these different people in a classroom, that's an asset.
Mm-hmm.
That should be honored and celebrated. And so, you know, that was always my goal. And I believe that it's really the goal of all educators. You know, I think educators walk in a classroom every day. They see their students. They want to see their students. And they look forward to educating those students and using those students' culture and their experiences and who they are to celebrate it all year long. I think that's really, really important.
I think an important point to make, because you mentioned it comes from home, and to some degree, some of it comes from home, but a lot of it is cultural.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of it is, you know, the commercials we see, the TV shows we watch, the way advertising is done. You mentioned it with books. You know, you're seeing more books with mm-hmm. kids with glasses, kids with braces, maybe even a kid with a prosthetic, a kid with two moms, kid with two dads. Right. So we're making an effort to say that these are all normal things. But 20, 30 years ago, every book character was white with a mom and a dad and probably a sibling or two. And so that became what was normal as opposed to all these different normals mm-hmm. that are out there.
Yeah. And there's this theory out of books, using books as a mirror and a window. So mirror, when books are mirroring you, they reflect, you know, your culture. You can see yourself in that book, for example.
I saw a lot of myself in a lot of the books I read growing up.
Right. But like when I was growing up, like I don't remember seeing any Filipino or, you know, Asian main characters in any of the books that I read growing up. Mm-hmm. There's a TED Talk out about this. Grace Lynn, she mentions this this theory of, you know, books as windows and mirrors, mm-hmm. But books being windows. So there's people that, you know, that they do see themselves in all these books. But the fact that nowadays you can get books to learn about other cultures or to experience other cultures, or not just cultures, different, you know, different situations that people have to go through. Mm-hmm. There are a plethora of books out there about anything that you can imagine. And so when teachers are intentional about picking out those books, not just to reflect the class makeup, but maybe to even teach them about different things, you know, that opens their eyes to, you know, the world out there.
It does. I have to share a story because I literally just gave Ted's youngest daughter, mm-hmm. for her birthday.
I was just thinking about
a
this.
Book. Were you?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And it was definitely, I mean, I remember when I picked it up, I was like, this is the perfect book, as I Promise, about LeBron James. And it's such a great story just for kids about what they promise about being the very best humans that they can be. And I said, when I gave it to her, I was like, oh my gosh, she's going to be like, whoa, look at all these kids. They look just like me, but they don't look like mm-hmm. me either. And this is so cool.
Yeah.
And she was so happy to get
she
it.
She was. I read it to her that first night we got back that night. She enjoyed it. Uh-huh. It was good. And it is. It's good for her to see little kids that don't look like her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it's powerful. And I think that is what we have right now. That for everything that people think is like, you know, because we have a lot of course, we can always talk about all the challenges that we have, right? But we also get to talk about the opportunities that we have too, and the opportunities to provide great literature for our students, great storytelling, being very intentional as a parent and even as a pre-K parent to make sure that you're taking your students and you're exposing them to the museums and things of that nature that they normally would not partake in. Those things are critical because culture is everything. It's not one or two or three things. Mm-hmm. It's everything. And even within our own culture of me being African-American, you being Filipino, and you being white, within our own cultures, there's also this big picture of culture too, in terms of our American culture and what that is. So very, very special. And it's always good to celebrate every part of who we are as a country.
I don't know if this is a good opportunity to talk about kind of the nuts and bolts of the pre-K program for parents who might be interested in enrolling their kids. How can they do it? How early can they do it? That type of thing.
Yeah. So in Mesquite, we do have a couple different options. We have a bilingual pre-K 3 program over at Seaburn and at Henry. They do amazing things. Y'all, three-year-olds, keeping three-year-olds in a class for half the day. It is a half-day program. Y'all need to visit sometime because our teachers over there do an amazing job of, you know, just exposing our kids to the basics. It's mm-hmm. and even beyond that, like I know that we've adopted new curriculum for both pre-K 3 and pre-K 4 this year, and one of the big things in new adoptions in these years is STEM. So even with three-year-olds, they're
right.
You know, science, technology, engineering, and math with three-year-olds.
Yep.
Fun times. So, so we have that program. It's language. You can qualify with for that through language if you're, a limited English speaker. You can look into that program. For our pre-K 4s, there are some different ways that you can qualify language also. Mm-hmm. We have bilingual Spanish, English classes, and then we have monolingual classes. And then you can get, English as a second language supports in those classes. But you can qualify for pre-K-4 based on, you know, if language, again. And it doesn't just have to be Spanish dominant at home. Socioeconomic, economically disadvantaged is another thing. If your child is ever in a foster program, that's another thing that would qualify your student.
If they have a disability.
Disabilities.
We do have our identified.
Early childhood special ed classes as well. So there's lots of options out there for, you know, our threes and four-year-olds. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just looking forward to all the amazing things that these little kids get exposed to in our pre-K program and then, you know, move up into the upper grades as they, you know, get older.
It really demonstrates clearly how when you add the equity component and making sure that every single student is getting exactly what they need, that we all win.
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm. And we were talking earlier about, you know, just the equity part. Like, not everybody is coming to school on the same page. Pre-K will allow, you know, the year in pre-K that the kids spend with us, it will help us to get them on the page with you know, their you know, kindergarten counterparts. Mm-hmm. So I'm really happy that our program has the resources that it does and that our district is very supportive with the early, you know, childhood initiatives and it's a good place to be here in Mesquite.
It's a big deal because when you're if you didn't have the pre-K program, kids are getting into kindergarten way behind. And once you start behind, it's hard to keep up.
It is.
And now we've got, you know, we're allowing 3-year-olds and you can build them up so they are more prepared and better ready to learn in kindergarten at that level and then keep up with their classmates.
Yeah. And even, you know, just giving them the opportunity to be in school and being in a structured environment, you know, it's not all the time that they're going to grasp all the academic things that you're teaching in pre-K, but they will get the basics of, oh, the teacher says I need to sit in a chair. Like, they'll be able to sit in a chair. Or, you know, I know how to work with my friend here in center time. So, like, just that social part of being in school and interacting with other people, other adults and kids, like, you know, that's part of our guidelines. We, in pre-K, we don't have TEKS. We don't follow TEKS. We have pre-K, the Texas pre-K guidelines is what we follow. And we have a social emotional learning domain. So that whole domain right there is based on, you know, interactions. There's one on language and communication. Speaking out when you need help. I mean, our pre-K guidelines are developmentally appropriate practices for our youngest learners. So, I mean, that's available on the TEA website, I believe. Mm-hmm. Parents, you are more than welcome to see what it is that we do in our classrooms because everything is based off of those guidelines. And you may think that they are very simple, very basic, but you know what? We have to start somewhere. And once our kids grasp that basic, you know, we can push them. Like our teachers are very well skilled at pushing them to, you know, get even more.
That is our first tricultural guest.
Yes.
Jean Pricer, thank you.
Well, you're so welcome. Thank
Appreciate
you for having me on.
Yeah, she is the pre-K facilitator for Mesquite ISD. And we welcome you listeners to join into the conversation by emailing us questions or issues or topics at letstalk@mesquiteisd.org, or you can get on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram and find us using the search term LetMISD. For Dr. LaDonna Gully, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next week.